To be or not to be? That is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take up arms against a sea of troubles and, by opposing, end them. To die, to sleep no more, and by a sleep to say we end the heartache of the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die, to sleep, to sleep. Perchance to dream. Aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the insolence of office, the law's delay, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin? Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, were it not that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveller returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others we know not of. Thus, conscience doth make cowards of us all. And thus, the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought. And enterprises of great pith and moment, with this regard their currents turn awry, and lose the name of action. But soft, fair Ophelia, nymph, in thy orisons be all my sins remembered.
Good my lord, how does your honour for this many a day?
So humbly, thank you, well, well, well.
My honoured lord, I have remembrances of yours that I have longed to re-deliver. I pray you, now receive them.
No, not I. I never gave you aught.
My honoured lord, you know right well that you did, and with them words of so sweet breath composed as made the things more rich, their perfume lost. Take these again, for to the noble mind rich gifts wax poor when givers prove unkind. There, my lord.
Are you honest?
My lord?
Are you fair?
What means your lordship?
That if you be honest and fair, then your honesty should admit no discourse to your beauty.
Could beauty, my lord, better than of commerce than with honesty?
I did love you once.
Indeed, my lord, you made me believe so.
You should not have believed me, I loved you not.
I was the more deceived.
I'll get thee to a nunnery. Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? I am myself indifferent, honest. I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious. With more offences at my bet than I have time to act them in, imagination to give them shape, or thoughts to put them in. What should such fellows as I do crawling between earth and heaven? We are arrant knaves all, believe none of us. Go thy ways to a nunnery. Where's your father?
At home, my lord.
Then let the doors be shut upon him, that he may play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Oh, help him, you sweet heavens.
Get thee to a nunnery, go, or if thou wilt marry, marry a fool, for wise men know what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery, go, farewell.
Heavenly powers, restore him.
God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig, you amble, and you lisp, and make your wantonness your ignorance. I'll no more aunt. It hath made me mad. I say we shall have no more marriages. Those who are married already, all but one, shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. To a nunnery go. Farewell.
Oh, what a noble mind is here overthrown. The courtiers, soldiers, scholars, eye, tongue, sword. The expectancy and rose of the fair state. The glass of fashion and the mould of form, the observed of all observers quite down. And I, the lady's most deject and wretched, that sucks the honey of his music fowls, now see that noble and most sovereign reason, like sweet bells jangled out of tune and harsh, that unmatched form and feature have blown you blasted with ecstasy. Oh, woe is me, to see what I have seen, and to see what I see.
Love? His affections do not that way tend. Nor what he spake, though it lacked form a little, it was not like madness. There's something settled in his soul, over which his melancholy sits on brood, and I do doubt the hatching the disclose will be some danger, which, for to prevent, he shall with speed to England. Happily, the seas and the countries shall expel this something settled matter from his heart. What think you, aunt?
It shall do well. But yet do I believe the origin and commencement of his grief sprang from neglected love. How now, Ophelia? You need not tell us what Lord Hamlet said. We heard it all. My lord, do as you please.
It shall be so. Madness in great ones must not unwatched go.
Speech, I pray you, as I pronounced it to you, trippingly, on the tongue. But if you mouth it, as many of your players do, I had as lief the town crier had spoke my lines. Nor do not saw the air too much with your hand thus, but use all gently. For in the very torrent, tempest, and, as I may say, the whirlwind of passion, you must acquire and beget a temperance that may give it smoothness.
I warrant, your honour.
Be not too tame, neither, but let your own discretion be your tutor. Suit the word to the action to the word. The purpose of playing, both at the first and now, was and is to hold the mirror up to nature. Now this overdone or come tardy off, though it make the unskillful laugh, cannot but make the judicious grieve, the censure of the which one must in your allowance or a whole theatre of others.
I hope we have reformed that indifferently with us, sir.
Or reform it altogether. Don't make you ready. How now, my lord? Will the king hear this piece of work?
And the queen too, and that presently.
Bid the players make haste. What ho, Horatio?
Here, sweet lord. At your service as ever.
Horatio, thou art in as just a man as ere my conversation coped withal.
Oh, my dear lord.
Nay, do not think I flatter. But what advancement may I hope from thee, that no revenue hast but thy own good spirits to feed and clothe thee? Why should the poor be flattered? But thou hast been a man who, in suffering all, suffers nothing. A man who fortunes, buffets, and rewards hast ta'en with equal thanks. Give me that man, who is not passion's slave, and I will wear him in the core of my heart. Aye, my heart's heart, as I do thee. Say too much of this. There is a play tonight before the king. One scene of it comes near the circumstance which I have told thee of my father's death. I prithee, when thou seest that act of foot, even with the very comment of thy soul, observe mine uncle. For I, mine eyes, will rivet to his face, and after we will both our judgments join in censure of his seeming.
Well, my lord, if a steal aught, the whilst the play is playing and scape detecting, I will pay the theft.
Coming to the play, I must be idle. Get you a place.
Thank you.
fares our cousin Hamlet?
Excellent, i' faith. Of the chameleon's dish. I eat the air, promise crammed. You cannot feed capons so.
I have nothing with this answer, Hamlet. These words are not mine.
No, nor mine now. My lord, you played once at the university, you say?
That did I, my lord, and was accounted a good actor.
What did you enact?
I did enact Julius Caesar. I was killed in the capital. Brutus killed me.
It was a brute part of him indeed to kill so capital a calf there. Be the players ready?
Just stay upon your patience.
Come hither, my dear Hamlet. Sit by me.
No, mother, here's metal more attractive.
Oh, do you mark that?
Lady, shall I lie in your lap?
No, my lord.
I mean my head upon your lap.
Aye, my lord.
Did you think I meant country matters?
I think nothing, my lord.
That's a fair thought, to lie between a maid's legs.
What is, my lord?
Nothing.
You are merry, my lord.
Who, I?
Aye, my lord.
Oh, God, you're only jig-maker. What should a man do but be merry? For look you, how cheerfully my mother looks. And my father died within these 2 hours.
Nay, 'tis twice 2 months, my lord.
So long? Nay, then, let the devil wear black, for I'll have a suit of sables. Oh, heavens, died 2 months ago and not forgotten yet. Why, then, there's hope a great man's memory may outlive his life half a year.
For us and for our tragedy, here stooping to your clemency, we beg your hearing patiently.
Is this a prologue or the posy of a writ?
'Tis brief, my lord.
As woman's love.
You are not. I'll mark the play.
Madam, how you like this play?
The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
Oh, but she'll keep her word.
You are as good as a chorus, my lord.
I could interpret between you and your love if I could see the puppets dallying.
You are keen, my lord, you are keen.
It would cost you a groaning to take off my edge.
Still better and worse.
So you must take your husband's. Marry, this is my king Malico, it means mischief.
Belike the show imports the argument of the play.
Have you heard the argument? Is there no offence in it?
No, they do but jest. Poison in jest, no offence of the world.
What do they call this play?
The Mousetrap. Marry how? Tropically. This play is the image of a murder done in Vienna. This is one Lucianus, nephew to the king. Begin, murderer pox! Leave thy damnable faces and begin. Come, the croaking raven doth bellow for revenge. He poisons him in the garden for his estate. His name's Gonzago. The story is extant and written choice Italian. You shall see anon how the murderer gets the love of Gonzago's wife.
The king rises.
What, frighted with false fire?
Affairs, my lord.
Give over the play.
Give me some light! Away!
Light!
Ladies and gentlemen, the king and the court are indisposed. Please find refreshments in the marquee. There will now be a 20-minute interval.
Thank you.
forest of feathers get me a fellowship in a cry of players, sir?
A half a share.
A whole one eye. Oh, good Horatio, I'll take the ghost word for £1,000. Dip to see.
Very well, my lord.
Upon the talk of the poisoning.
I did very well, Moti.
Come some music, come the recorders. For if the king like not the comedy, why then he likes it not, puddy. Come some music.
Good, my lord. Vouchsafe me a word with you.
Sir, a whole history.
The king, sir.
Aye, sir, what of him?
Is in his retirement marvellous distempered.
With drink, sir?
No, my lord, rather with choler.
Your wisdom should signify this to his doctor.
Good, my lord, put your discourse into some frame.
I am tame, sir, pronounce.
And the queen, your mother, in most great affliction of spirit, had sent me to you.
And you are welcome!
Nay, good, my lord, this curtsy is not the right breed. If it shall please you to make me a wholesome answer, I will do your mother's commandment. If not, your pardon and my return shall be the end of my business.
Sir, I cannot.
What, my lord?
Grant you a wholesome answer. My wit's diseased, therefore no more, but to the matter. My mother, you say.
Then thus she says, your behaviour has struck her into amazement and admiration.
Oh, most wonderful son that can so astonish a mother. But is there no sequel? In part.
She desires to speak to you in her closet ere you go to bed.
We shall obey, were she 10 times our mother. Have you any further trade with us?
My lord, you did once love me.
So do I still, by these pickers and stealers.
Good, my lord. What is your cause of distemper? You do surely bar the door upon your own liberty if you deny your griefs to your friend.
Sir, I lack advancement.
How can that be? When you have the voice of the king himself for your succession in Denmark.
Aye, but sir, while the grass grows, the proverb is something musty. Ah, the recorders, let me see them. They withdraw with you, sir. Why do you go about to recover the wind of me?
Oh, my lord, if my duty be too bold, my love is too unmanly.
I do not well understand that. Will you play upon this pipe?
My lord, I cannot.
I pray you.
Believe me, I cannot.
I do beseech you.
I know no touch of it, my lord.
Why, 'tis as easy as lying. Govern these ventages with your fingers and thumb. Give it breath with your mouth, and it will discourse most eloquent music. Look you, these are the stops.
But these cannot I command to any utterance of harmony. I have not the skill.
Why, what an unworthy thing you make of me. You would play upon me. You would seem to know my stops. You would sound me from my lowest note to the top of my compass, and there is much music, yes, excellent voice, in this little organ. Yet you cannot make it speak. Splud! Do you think I am easier to be played on than a pipe? Call me what instrument you will, though you can fret me, yet you cannot play upon me. God bless you, sir.
My lord, the queen will speak with you presently.
Dost thou see yonder clown? It's almost in shape of a camel.
By the mass, and is like a camel indeed.
Methinks it is like a weasel.
It is back like a weasel.
Or like a whale.
Very like a whale.
I will come to my mother by and by. They fool me to the top of my bent. I will come by and by.
I will say so.
By and by is easily said. Leave me, friends.
Tis now the very witching time of night, when churchyards yawn, and hell itself breathes out contagion to this world. Now could I drink hot blood, and do such bitter business as the day would quake to look upon. But soft, now to my mother. O heart, lose not thy nature. Let not ever the soul of Nero enter this firm bosom. Let me be cruel, not unnatural. I will speak daggers to her, but use none. All my tongue and soul in this be hypocrite.
I like him not. Nor stands it safe with us to let his madness range. Therefore, prepare you. I, your commission, shall forthwith dispatch, and he shall to England, along with you. Terms of our estate may not endure hazards so dangerous as doth hourly grow out of his lunacies.
And we will ourselves provide most holy and religious fear it is to keep those many, many bodies safe that live and feed upon your majesty.
That spirit upon whose will depend and rest the lives of many. Never alone did the king side but with a general groan.
Arm you, I pray you, to this speedy voyage, for we will fet us put upon this fear that now grows too free-footed.
Aye, my liege.
My lord, he's going to his mother's closet. Behind the arras I'll convey myself to hear the process. I'll warrant you tax him home. Fare you well, my liege. I'll call upon you ere you go to bed and tell you what I know.
Thanks, dear my lord. Oh, my offence is rank. It smells to heaven. It has the primal eldest curse upon't. A brother's murder. Pray, can I not, though inclination be as sharp as will, my stronger guilt defeats my strong intent. What if this cursed hand were thicker than itself with brother's blood? Is there not rain enough in the sweet heavens to wash it white as snow? Then I'd look up. My fault is past. No. What form of prayer can serve my turn? Forgive me my foul murder. That cannot be. For I'm still possessed of those effects for which I did the murder. My crown, mine own ambition, and my queen. May one be pardoned and yet retain the offence. In the corrupted currents of this world, it is often seen that offence's gilded hand may shove by justice, and the wicked prize itself may buy out the law. Tis not so above. There is no shuffling. There the action lies in his true nature. Oh, what then? What rests? Try what repentance may. What may it not? But what can it when one cannot repent? Oh, wretched state! Oh, bosom black as death! Limed soul that's struggling to be free art more engaged. Help, angels! Make a say. Bow, stubborn knees. All may be well.
Now might I do it, Pat. Now he is praying. And now I'll do't! And so he goes to heaven! And so am I revenged. That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for this I, his sole son, to this same villain, send to heaven. Oh, this is higher in salary, not revenge. He took my father grossly, full of bread, with all his crimes broad-blown as flush as May. Am I then revenged to take him in the purging of his soul, when he is fit and seasoned for his passage? No. Up, blade, and know thou a more horrid hint. When he is drunk asleep, or in his rage, or in the incestuous pleasure of his bed, then trip him, that his heels may kick at heaven, and that his soul may be as damned and black as hell whereto it goes. My mother stays. This physic but prolongs thy sickly days.
Words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go.
He will come straight. Look you lay home to him. Tell him his pranks have been too broad to bear with, and that your grace hath screened and stood between much heat and him. Ask on to be even here.
Mother, mother.
Pray you, be round with him.
I'll warrant you, fear me not. Withdraw, I hear him coming.
Now, mother, what's the matter?
Hamlet, thou hast thy father much offended.
Mother, thou hast my father much offended.
Come, come, you answer with an idle tongue.
Go, go, you question with a wicked tongue.
Why, how now, Hamlet?
What's the matter now?
Have you forgot me?
No, by the rood, not so. You are the queen, your husband's brother's wife, and, would it were not so, you are my mother.
Nay then, I'll set those to you that can speak.
Come, come and sit you down. You shall not budge. You go not till I set you up a glass where you might see the inmost part of you.
What will I do? Thou will not murder me? Help! Help!
What? Ho? Help! Help! Oh, no. Help!
A rat dead or a duck dead!
I am slain!
Me? What hast thou done?
Nay, I know not. Is it the king?
What a rash and bloody deed is this?
A bloody deed? Almost as bad, good mother, as kill a king and marry with his brother.
As kill a king?
Aye, lady, 'twas my word. Oh, thou wretched, rash, intruding fool. Farewell. I took thee for thy better. Take thy fortune. Thou find'st to be too busy is some danger. Leave wringing of your hands. Peace. Sit you down. And let me wring of your heart. For so I shall, if it be made of penetrable stuff, if damned custom hath not brassed it so that it is proof and bulwark against sense.
What have I done that thou darest wag thy tongue in noise so rude against me?
Such an act that blurs the grace and blush of modesty, calls virtue hypocrite, plucks off the fair rose from the forehead of an innocent love and sets a blister there, makes marriage vows as false as dice's oaths.
Ay me! What act that roars so loud and thunders in the index?
Look here, upon this picture, and upon this, the counterfeit presentment of two brothers. See what a grace was seated on this brow. Hyperion's curls, the front of Jove himself, an eye like Mars to threaten and command, a station like the herald Mercury new lighted on a heaven-kissing hill, a form indeed where every god did seem to set his seal, to give the world assurance of a man. This was your husband. Look you now what follows. This is your husband, like a mildewed ear blasting his wholesome brother. Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age the heyday in the blood is tame. It's humble and waits upon the judgment. And what judgment would step from this to this? Sense, sure, you have, else you could not have motion, but sure that sense is apoplexed. What devil was that hath cozened you at Hoodman blind? Oh, shame, where is thy blush?
Oh, Hamlet, speak no more to me. Thou turn'st mine eyes into my very soul. There I see such black and grained spots as will not leave their tint.
Nay, but to live in the rank sweat of an ensemed bed, stewed in corruption, honeying and making love over the nasty star.
Oh, speak no more. Words like daggers enter mine ears. No more, sweet Hamlet.
A murderer and a villain, a slave that is not 20th part.
No more.
A king of shreds and patches. Oh, save me, and hover on me with your wings, or you heavenly guards. What would your gracious figure?
Alas, he's mad.
Do you not come your tardy son to chide? That lapsed in time and passion, let go by the important acting of your dread command. Oh, say.
Do not forget. This visitation is but to whet thy almost blunted purpose. But look, amazement on thy mother sits. Oh, step between her and her fighting soul. Conceit in weakest body's strongest works. Speak to her, Hamlet.
How is with you, lady?
Alas, how is with you? You do bend your eye on vacancy, and with incorporeal air do hold discourse. Forth at your eyes, your spirits wildly peep. Your bedded hair starts up and stands on end. Oh, gentle sun, upon the heat and flame of this distemper, sprinkle cool patience. Where do you look?
On him! On him! Look you how pale he glares! But do not look upon me! Lest with this piteous action you convert my stern effects. Then what I have to do will want true colour, tears perchance for blood.
To whom do you speak this?
Do you see nothing there?
No, nothing at all. Yet all that is I see.
Nor do you nothing here?
Nothing but ourselves.
Why look you there? Look where it steals away. My father in his habit as he lived. Look where he goes even now out at the portal.
This is the very coinage of your brain. This bodiless creation ecstasy is in this very cunning.
Ecstasy? My pulse as yours doth temperately keep time and makes as healthful music. It is not madness that I have uttered. Bring me to the test and either matter will reword which madness would gamble from. Mother, for love of grace, may not that flattering unction to your soul that not your trespass but my madness speaks. Confess yourself to heaven. Repent what's past. Avoid what is to come. And do not spread the compost on the weeds to make them ranker. Forgive me this, my virtue.
Oh, Hamlet, thou hast cleft my heart in twain.
Oh, throw away the worser part of it, and live the purer with the other half. Good night. But go not to mine uncle's bed. Assume a virtue if you have it not. Refrain tonight, for that shall lend a kind of easiness to the next abstinence, the next more easy. For use almost can change the stamp of nature. Once more, good night. And will now be desirous to be blessed, our blessing beg of you. For this same Lord, I do repent. Though heaven hath pleased it so to punish me with this, and this with me, I will bestow him, and will answer well the death I gave him. Once more, good night. I must be cruel only to be kind. Thus bad begins and worse remains behind. One word more, good lady.
What shall I do?
Not this by any means that I bid you do. Let the bloat king tempt you again to bed, pinch wanton in your cheek, call you his mouse, and for a pair of reachy kisses, or paddling in your neck with his damned fingers, make you to ravel all this matter out, that I essentially am not in madness, but mad in craft.
Be thou assured. Words be made of breath, and breath of life. They have no life to breathe what thou hast spoke to me.
I must to England. You know that?
Alack, I had forgot. It is so concluded.
There's letters sealed, and my two schoolfellows, whom I will trust as I will adders fanged, they bear the mandate. They must sweep my way and marshal me to knavery. Let it work. For 'tis the sport to have the engineer hoist with his own petard, and shall go hard, for I will delve 1 yard below their minds and blow them at the moon. Oh, 'tis most sweet when in 1 line 2 crafts directly meet. Mother, good night. This man shall set me packing. I'll lug the guts into the neighbour room. Indeed, this counsellor is now most still, most secret, and most grave, who was in life a foolish, prating knave. Come, sir, to withdraw with you. Good night, mother.
In these sighs, these profound heaves. You must translate as fit we understand. Where is your son?
Bestow this place on us a while. Oh, good Lord, what have I seen tonight?
What, Gertrude? How fares Hamlet?
Mad, as the sea and wind, when both contend which is mightier. Behind the arras, hearing something stir, in his lawless fit whips out a dagger, cries, a rat! And in this brainish apprehension, kills the unseen good old man.
Oh, heavy deed! It had been so with us had we been there. His threats, This liberty is full of threats to all, to you, yourself, to us, to everyone. Oh, how shall this bloody deed be answered? It will be laid to us, whose providence should have kept short restrained and out of haunt this mad young man. So much was our love, we would not understand what was most fit. Like the owner of a foul disease, to keep it from divulging, let it feed even on the pith of life. Where is he gone?
To draw apart the body he hath killed, on whom his very madness, like some ore among a metal of minerals base, shows itself pure. He weeps for what is done.
Oh, Gertrude, the sun shall no sooner the mountains touch, but we must ship him hence, and this bloody deed, with all our majesty and skill, we must both countenance and excuse. Ho, oh, Goldenstern! Friends, both, go join me with some further aid. Hamlet in madness hath Polonius slain, and from his mother's closet hath he dragged the body. I pray you seek him out. Speak fair, and bring the body into the chapel. I pray you haste in this. Gertrude, we'll call up our wisest friends and tell them both what's untimely done and what we mean to do. Oh, Gertrude, come away. My soul is full of discord and dismay.
Safely stowed.
Hamlet!
Oh, what noise? Who calls on Hamlet? Oh, here they come.
What have you done, my lord, with the dead body?
Compounded it with dust, where to his kin.
My lord, you must tell us where it is, that we may take it thence and bear it to the chapel.
Do not believe it.
Believe what?
That I can keep your own counsel and not mine own. Besides, to be demanded of a sponge.
Take you me for a sponge, my lord?
Aye, sir, that soaks up the king's countenances, his rewards, his authorities. He keeps you in the corner of his jaw, first mouthed to be last swallowed. When he wants what you have, it is but squeezing you, and sponge, you shall be dry again.
I understand you not, my lord.
I'm glad of it. A knavish speech sleeps in a foolish ear.
My lord, you must tell us where the body is and go with us to the king.
The body is with the king. But the king is not with the body. The king is a thing.
A thing, my lord?
Of nothing. Bring me to him. I fox and all after.
I have sent to seek him out and to find the body. How dangerous is it that this man goes loose? But we must not use the strong law upon him. He's loved of the distracted multitude, who like not in their judgment but in their eyes. To bear all smooth and even, this sudden sending away must seem like deliberate pause. How now? What hath occurred?
Well, the dead body's bestowed, my lord, we cannot get from him.
Where is he?
Without, my lord, a guarded to know your pleasure.
Bring him before us.
Bring him, my lord.
Now, Hamlet, where's Polonius?
At supper.
At supper? Where?
Not where he eats, but where he is eaten. A certain convocation of politic worms are in at him. Your worm is your only emperor for diet. We fat all creatures else to fat us. We fat ourselves for maggots.
Oh, alas, alas!
A man may fish with the worm that hath eat of a king, and eat of the fish which hath fed of that worm.
What dost thou mean by this?
Nothing but to show you how a king may go progress through the guts of a beggar.
Where is Polonius?
In heaven! Send hither to see. If your messenger find him not there, seek him in the other place yourself. But, indeed, if you find him not within this month, you shall nose him as you go up the stairs into the lobby.
Go, seek him there.
He will stay till ye come.
Hamlet, this special deed for thine own safety, which we do tender as dearly as we do grieve for that which thou hast done, must send thee hence with fiery quickness. Therefore prepare yourself. The bark is ready. The associates tend, the wind is at help, and everything is bent for England.
For England?
Aye, Hamlet.
Good.
So it is, if thou knewest our purposes.
I see a cherub that sees them. But come, for England. Farewell, dear mother.
Thy loving father, Hamlet.
My mother? Mother and father is man and wife. Man and wife is one flesh, and therefore, my mother. Come, for England!
Follow him at foot. Tempt him with speed aboard. I'll have him hence tonight. Delay it not, for everything is sealed and done that else leans on this affair. I pray you, haste in this.
and England. If my love thou hold'st at aught, as my great power might give thee sense, and thy kingdom pays tribute to the Danish throne, thou mayst not coldly set aside our sovereign processes, which import at full, through letters congruing, the present death of Hamlet. Do it, England, for like the hectic in my blood he rages, and thou must cure me! Till I know 'tis done, whate'er my haps, my joy were ne'er begun.
Distract. Her mood will needs be pitied.
What would she have?
She speaks much of her father. She says she hears his tricks in the world and beats her heart. Spends enviously its stores, speaks things in doubt that carry but half sense. Her speech is nothing. Her winks, her nods, her gestures indeed would make one think there might be thought, though nothing sure, yet much unhappily.
'Twere good she were spoken with, for she may strew dangerous conjectures in ill-breeding minds.
Let her come in. My sick soul, sin's true nature is. Each toy seems prologue to some great amiss. So full of artless jealousy is guilt, it spills itself fearing to be spilt.
Where is the beauteous majesty of Denmark?
How now, Ophelia?
How should I your true love know from another one? By his cockle hat and staff and his sandal shoe.
Alas, sweet maid, what imports this song?
Say you, nay, pray you, mark. He is dead and gone, lady. He is dead and gone. At his head a grass green turf, at his heels a stone.
Nay, Ophelia!
Pray you, mark. White his shroud as the mountain snow.
That's my lord, look here.
Flooded with sweet flowers, which be wept to the grave did go, with true love showers.
How do you, pretty lady?
Well, God lead you.
They say the owl was a baker's daughter. Lord, we know what we are, but not know what we may be. God be at your table.
Conceit upon her father.
Pray you!
Let's have no more words of this. But when they ask you what it means, say you this. Tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, all in the morning betime. And I a maid at your window to be your valentine. Then up he rose and donned his clothes and dubbed the chamber door. Let him the maid that out a maid never departed more.
Pretty Ophelia.
Indeed, la. Without an oath, I'll make an end on it. By she's and by Saint Charity, alack and fie for shame. Young men will do it if they come to it. By cock they are to blame. Quoth she before you tumbled me, you promised me to wed. So what I had done by yonder sun, and thou hadst not come to my bed.
How long hath she been thus?
I hope all will be well. He must be patient. But I cannot choose but weep to think they should lay his cold body in the ground. My brother shall know of it, and so I thank you for your good counsel. Come, my coach. Good night, pretty ladies. Good night, sweet ladies. Good night, good night, good night.
Follow her close and give her good watch, I pray you. Oh, this is the poison of deep grief. It springs all from her father's death. Gertrude,
When sorrows come, they come not single spies, but in battalions. First her father slain, next your son gone, and he the most violent author of his own just remove. The people muddied, thick and unwholesome in their thoughts and their whispers for good Polonius' death, and we have done but greenly in hugger-mugger to inter him. Poor Ophelia, divided from herself and from her fair judgment. And last, her brother is in secret come from France, feeds on his wonder, keeps his head in the clouds, and once not buzzes to infect his ears with pestilent speeches of his father's death that will nothing stick our person to arraign in ear and ear. Oh, Gertrude, this, like unto a murdering piece in many places, gives me a superfluous death.
Right, what noise is this?
Where are my Switzers? Let them guard the doors. What is it?
Save yourself, my lord. Along the urches, this Rato's head, a bears your officers. The rabble call him lord. They cry, choose we, the urches shall be king. Caps, hands, tongues, applaud it to the clouds. Laertes shall be king. Laertes king!
This is counter, you false Danish dogs!
The doors are broken.
Thou vile king! Give me my father!
Calm me, good Laertes!
The drop of blood that's come proclaims me bastard, cries cuckold to my father.
What is the cause, Laertes, that thy rebellion looks so giant-like? Let him go, Gertrude. Do not fear our person. There's such divinity doth hedge a king. Why art thou thus incensed, Laertes? Let him go, Gertrude. Speak, man.
Where is my father?
Dead.
But not by him.
Let him demand his fill.
How came he dead? I'll not be juggled with to hell allegiance, vows to the blackest devil, conscience and grace to the profoundest pit. I dare damnation. To this point I stand. Let come what comes, only I'll be revenged most thoroughly for my father.
You? Who shall stay you?
My will, not all the world.
Good Laertes, if thou wouldst know the certainty of thy dear father's death, is written your revenge that you will draw both friend and foe, winner and loser?
None but his enemies.
Will you know them then?
To his good friends, thus wide I'll ope my arms.
Why, now you speak like a good child and a true gentleman, that I am guiltless of your father's death, and am most sensible in grief for it. It shall as level to your judgment peer as day doth to your eye. Thank you.